Okay, folks, we're back with lesson 4.5 on interest groups and lobbying. We're going to be talking about campaign finance today. What does that mean? That means money in politics, okay? And you may be aware by now, but if not, you should be, that we are spending more money on elections and on political campaigns than ever before. Over $1 billion has been spent on the last couple of presidential elections. And it just goes down from there. So it's big business, which we'll get into in a second. So we're thinking about today, how do campaign donations, interest groups, and lobbying give people influence over policy? Okay, remember, policy is are the things that government does, the decisions that government makes. So obviously, whenever a major decision is being made, people want to have some say in that, okay? So by the end of this, you'll understand the role that money, interest groups, and lobbying play in our political system. Don't worry about that activity. We're not going to get to that. And then there's some vocabulary here that will come up as we go through the lesson. Okay. So quick lesson opener. The review question is, national legislative candidates who spend the most money win what percentage of elections? So candidates who spend more money than their opponent win what percentage of the time? The warm-up, then, I want you to just pause and think about for a minute or two and then write something in your notes. Should people be allowed to give as much money as they want to politicians and to political campaigns? Just basic, right? I want to see what you think right now, and then we're going to talk about it through this lesson, and hopefully, at the very least, your opinion will become more informed, if not changed by what you learn, okay? And then you can see over on the right-hand side here, there's a pie chart with breaking down the nearly $12 billion that was spent on advertisements in the 2016 election. Okay, $12 billion. Okay, so we're going to skip the four corners for today. We'll do that later. So money in politics. Like I said before, we should know by now that politics is big business. There is a lot of money in it. Candidates are getting a lot of money to run their campaigns. That money is not given for free. That money is not given with no expectations. It's almost never given by people or interests who want nothing in return for it, right? If you're giving serious money to a political campaign, it's because you want something in return. So each election cycle, candidates need more and more money in order to compete because their competitors have more money. It's one of those things where it just sort of ratchets up, right? You never want to be the person spending less money. Elections are expensive. You need to pay staff, rental fees for event spaces, transportation costs. There's all types of, it's kind of like running a business. The largest expense by far is advertising, like TV, radio, internet. Stuff you get in the mail, print advertisements. So the candidate needs to get in front of people. They need to be more known, especially if they're not somebody like Donald Trump or candidates who already have a public profile and need to build one. So advertisements account for around 3/4 of what every campaign spends. So the question is, where does that money come from? Does everybody give a dollar at the beginning of election cycle season and then all that goes together and everybody has an equal say and that's how we get our $12 billion? Well, you can probably guess that that is not how it happens. Most campaign money does come from private sources, including individuals, but a very small percentage of that comes from regular working people like you and I, like teachers, firefighters, nurses, regular community members. The very, very wealthy, like the 1% of the 1%, account for a massive percentage of the money spent every election cycle. In 2014, there was some crazy stat that like 30,000 people, which is a tiny, tiny percentage of our 330 million people in this country, spent over $1 billion on the 2014 election cycle. Just those 30,000 people, okay? Then we have corporations. corporations are big campaign donors. Many of them are owned by those same very rich individual citizens. And then political action committees, which is a new term we're going to learn today. This is a political organization created by an interest group to support a candidate with money. That brings up the question, what is an interest group? You may know already what an interest group is. We're going to get into that a little bit later. The simple answer is that an interest group is a group of regular people who get together and make their voice louder by working together, right? So the great example of an interest group in the United States would be the National Rifle Association, the NRA. Okay, so that has like 3 million members from all across the country, all different walks of life, white, black, rich, poor. But their big interest group, right? Their big interest is protecting their right to own a gun. So by working together instead of working separately, by working together, they become more powerful and they spin off from the interest group these political action committees that they can donate to as kind of a group to make their donations more substantial and then push those donations around to different candidates that they think will protect, in this case, guns or whatever the interest is that they're trying to protect. Okay. So the categories of campaign contributions, this is getting a little bit into the political science weeds here, but there have traditionally been two categories for campaign contributions. Hard money, which is money raised and spent directly to elect candidates for Congress and the White House. It has one specific goal, and you donate that money directly to the candidate to achieve that goal. Okay, soft money is a little softer. It's a little more flexible, right? So these are funds given to party organizations, the Democratic National Committee, the Republican National Committee, for quote unquote party building activities. So you can't demand that your money go directly to a certain candidate, but you can give it to a party and say, I trust you as the party to give this money where it needs to go, whether that's to pay someone's salary or to pay for advertisements for some candidate 2,000 miles away in some other state I don't know about. Okay. Both of these types of contributions have limits. You can only give so much. So for hard money, if you're giving money directly to one single candidate for one single election cycle, there is a maximum of $2,800 that you can donate. $2,800. For most of us, that's still outside of what we'd be able to spend. But again, remember, compared to 12 billion, it's a small, 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 small percentage of that. Soft money is more significant. You can give more of that. $100,000 is sort of the cutoff point for each election cycle. So again, when you wonder why are parties so powerful, why do we have these two powerful Democrat and Republican parties? Well, they got a lot of money coming in, okay? And in this country, and in our political system, the way that we've set it up and the rules that we've made for it, money is power, okay? You can see this little cartoon over here on the right-hand side. This young person is asking their father for some soft money, right? They don't want a bigger allowance. That's hard money. That's money directly to me. I want some of that soft money. Let me get some more of that. Now, over the past 10 years, a new category has been invented called dark money. And this comes from the invention, the creation of super PACs, super political action committees. Okay, these are a mutant form of PACs that developed after the Citizens United Supreme Court decision, which we're going to learn about in just a second. But essentially, what the Supreme Court said was that, in fact, individuals, corporations, unions, groups of people, interest groups, whatever, could spend as much money as they wanted on a political campaign, as long as they didn't work directly with that campaign. Okay, so super PACs take in billions of dollars a year and spend that to get certain candidates elected. But technically, legally, their message, the Super PAC message, but must be completely independent from the campaign's message. If they do that, which we'll see in a second how easy in some ways that is to do, they must be completely, sorry, if they do that, they can donate unlimited amounts of cash and they don't even have to tell the government or us that they're spending it. So this money is therefore dark, right? It's not being brought into the light. We don't know the source of the money. So again, people and corporations can donate unlimited amounts to these super PACs, and they don't even have to say who they are. And so we know, right? So again, $1 billion spent by super PACs during the 2016 election. Couple of Supreme Court cases we need to be aware of. Nixon versus Shrink Missouri Government PAC back in 2000. This was when the Supreme Court decided that it would uphold federal limits on campaign contributions. Okay, that also applies to state limits on campaign contributions to state offices. So as I told you, 2,800 in hard money and 100,000 in soft money. In 2010, the Citizens United decision, Citizens United versus FEC, the court decided that political spending is actually protected under the Constitution, under the First Amendment. They ruled that money, the spending of money, is a form of free speech. So I want to express myself by going out and buying a car. I can do that. In the same way, the court said that I can also express myself by going out and donating hundreds of thousands of dollars to a political candidate that I like. Okay? And not only me, but corporations got these massive companies with thousands and thousands of workers and billions of dollars. Corporations are technically people, and therefore they are protected by our First Amendment right to free speech. Okay? So political spending is protected as a form of free speech, and corporations, after this case, are considered people. Okay? But again, whatever political activity they do must be independent of a political candidate. They cannot coordinate their message between them. Okay? So super PACs that give unlimited contributions as long as it doesn't coordinate message with the candidate. Okay, so you can pause that and jot down some notes about both of those two decisions. The Citizens United decision sort of it didn't go back on what they said in Nixon, but it did add this new piece to the puzzle. So I'm going to try to watch these two videos to show you how difficult it is to determine what is a campaign advertisement. Remember, so much money is spent on advertisements. What is a campaign advertisement paid for with hard and soft money contributions? And what is a super PAC ad paid for by dark money contributions? And remember, these two are supposed to be entirely independent. Okay, so that was our first one, right? Now we're going to watch the second one. So these are obviously two advertisements for Hillary Clinton back in 2016, but I could have pulled ones for Donald Trump, for Bernie Sanders this election cycle, for Joe Biden. But I wanted to show you two from the same campaign. Now, one of these is a Super PAC ad, and one of these is just an ad paid for by the campaign.
John McCain, a war hero, 5.5 years has a POW, and you call him a dummy. Is that appropriate in running for president? Okay.
He's not a war hero.
He's a war hero.
He's a war
five
hero.
And a half years
He's
has
a war hero because he was captured. I like people that weren't captured, okay? I hate to tell you.
Do you agree with that?
He's a war hero because he was captured.
I was in World War II in the European theater. Ultimately, I was captured after knocking out a bunker with a grenade. It was mainly hunger and cold and worrying whether the Germans were going to hurt us again. Apart from the outrage, the insult, the prisoners of war, he insulted all of our military. My war is 7 years. Ago and yesterday. It's everything I would not want to be or emulate, and I would hope we would not adulate a man like him and put him into the most precious office in this country.
John McCain, a war.
Okay, so what are we seeing here? One of those advertisements was Hillary for America. One of those advertisements by Ford with Hillary. but the thing I want you to see is not so much which is the Super PAC ad and which is the campaign advertisement, which we'll talk about tomorrow when we get together and discuss this, but they're not supposed to coordinate messages, right? The Super PAC in support of Hillary and the Hillary campaign. And maybe they don't. Maybe no one ever exchanges an email and says, hey, we need you to hit Donald Trump on this, or hey, we want you to highlight this. But ultimately, at the end of the day, what's the goal here? The goal is to get Hillary Clinton elected president. So they can't coordinate messages, but the same end goal is in mind. And it shows us that the Supreme Court can say, you know, they can't coordinate messages, but otherwise it's all good to go. But in actuality, what it actually means, the advertisements that we see and the way we vote based on those advertisements, is not, you know, it's not a significant difference between the campaign and the Super PAC. Okay. So in recent years, this idea of campaign finance reform, right, reforming, changing the system with which we use campaign finance. So this is a movement to change the rules to get money out of politics, just like gerrymandering reform, voting rights reform. But like those things, it's hard to pass because politicians who win elections benefit from spending a lot of money. We know from the top of the lesson that 95% of candidates who spend more money than their opponents win. Okay, so those people who have spent that money would have to turn around and say, you know what? I don't think I want to do that next time. I'm going to try to actually just win without spending more money. Okay, so interest groups. We talked a little bit about them before. They create political action committees to spend money for them in politics. They, again, though, are organizations of people with common interests that try to influence public policy. These are a major political organization, but they are not political parties. Political parties make nominations. Interest groups do not. Interest groups also have a much smaller scope of interests. Usually they have one single interest, whereas a political party, especially a political party in the United States, they have to have a position on all the different issues and interests of all Americans, right? Immigration, automobiles, guns, abortion, gay and lesbian rights, civil rights for people of color, mass incarceration, all of these interests a political party has to have a view on. Interest groups can just care about one thing and push that one thing, like the National Rifle Association and guns, which makes them very powerful when it comes to that specific thing, right? And they also differ in their primary focus. So political parties, remember, want to control government. Interest groups want to control the policies that government makes. They want to influence those policies that the government is trying to figure out. So we have a few types of interest groups here. Just go through these quickly. So big business, businesses have interest groups spun off of them, right? Like there are interest groups for car companies. There are interest groups for construction companies. And if you have a construction company, you can join that interest group and donate to them. And then your interest as a construction company owner can be shared and made more powerful with other construction company owners. Okay, economic interests, there are insurance interest groups, professional organizations, teachers, doctors, pharmacists, they have interest groups, special issues like guns, abortion, and there are also public interest groups that fight for the general public. So people who want to change the way that our environment is treated will get together and join one big interest group. How do interest groups influence public policy? So we know number two already, right? They create political action committees and spend money on elections. They also lobby, which is when people go to Washington and try to convince politicians to do what they want them to do. These are people who spend their careers getting to know politicians, taking them out, wining them, dining them, spending money on them, trying to convince them, hey, you really should not pass this gun law because I work for the NRA and those people really care about this certain gun law, okay? There's also propaganda, right? Interest groups use plenty of propaganda to try to influence the way people think, to try to get them to join their interest group, or to try to just get them to keep their elected politician from doing what the interest group doesn't want them to do. So how do they exert influence? They can do it directly through immediate face-to-face contact with lawmakers, like lobbying, funding the campaign, throwing campaign events. And as I told you, lobbyists are individuals or firms paid by interest groups to influence politicians in Washington and in state capitals. And they also can mobilize voters back home. These are indirect influence, where more subtle influence, where they go to the politician directly and say, hey, we need you to do this, we need you to support this bill. And the politician says, I'm not going to do that. They're okay, that's fine. We'll just go back to your home district where you need to get reelected in a couple years, and we'll get those voters to tell you why you need to support this bill. Or go ahead and put our money towards the guy or the person who's going to run against you in a couple years, and they'll have our support instead of you. Okay, so they're pressuring, and you could call it blackmailing, but they're definitely pressuring politicians to do the things they want them to do. All right. So, and this is just a list of the major industries and their what their interest groups have spent in recent years. Pharmaceutical industry has spent $3 billion and probably much more than that now on political spending, lobbying, propaganda, political action committees in the last few years. So these are major, major players. And it shows you the value of coming together as an interest group, right? Your money goes a lot further. So there are some good things and some bad things about interest groups. So I'll just put them up here because you need to create the T chart for yourself. So On the positive side, they help stimulate interest in public affairs. They represent shared attitudes. They provide useful, detailed information to government. They're vehicles for political participation, right? You may not be interested in either political party, but you know you're interested in keeping your guns. So you're going to join the NRA and support whichever politician or politicians you need to. They also add another element to checks and balances, which we're going to talk about later when we get to the Constitution unit. Negatives. They have influence out of proportion to their size, right? The NRA has basically held our country hostage in terms of laws about guns, you know, making protections stronger, background checks, etc. But because they're so powerful, even a relatively small group of people, we haven't been able to do anything. It's hard to tell how many people interest groups represent. They're not always required to report their numbers, and they're susceptible to bribery and corruption. When they want to influence politicians to do something, sometimes they'll go to great lengths to influence those politicians to do something, including just paying them outright for their help, right? And they don't always represent the views of people they claim to represent. Ultimately, somebody or a group of people is running the interest group and doesn't necessarily listen to what everybody else wants. Okay. So that's the last thing we're going to do. The exit ticket is just asking you to think about the warm-up again and what you learned in this lesson and whether you still think what you thought about whether people should be able to give as much money as they want to political campaigns. Okay. Okay, thank you very much.